Revolution Radio proudly presents, live from Phoenix, Arizona, the Truth Denied Talk Radio with host Roxy Lopez. Join us here for topics you won't hear about on mainstream news, such as chemtrails, GMOs, nutrition, and conspiracy facts regarding your personal sovereignty. Humanity is 7 billion strong. We are the majority. And now, live from the Valley of the Sun, your host, Roxy Lopez.
And another week has flown by. It's Friday, July 26th. Welcome to the Truth Denied Talk Radio. I'm Roxy Lopez, your host this evening. Hello, everybody, and thank you for joining us. We have a really exciting show this evening. And, you know, for those of you who have been commenting on Brad Olson's show that we did on Tuesday, you know, it's in the process. The awakening and disclosures and transparency, it's really starting to happen. And what I love about some of what I'm hearing, a lot of what I'm hearing these days, is that people are meeting people. One of my guests this evening, Sean Gautreaux, had some information films for two solid years, hundreds of hours of films. And when he finally connected with Jose Escamilla, who is, as you well know, a fairly well-known, world-renowned documentary maker, when the two connected, Sean was able to facilitate a missing link in Jose's 25 years of work with Rods. The same things happened to my guest on the show this evening. Sean hooked up with our other guest, Jim Kerr, and they started to fill in blanks and become sort of symbiotic with each other's work, if you will, filling in blanks or validating the information that they were each getting across the coast. And of course, our guest this evening, our third guest, who's known as Miss American Bunker, she also was able to facilitate Jim Kerr's work after Jim had done quite a bit of filming. So this is going to be very interesting, and that seems to be happening for those of you who are listening. Do you find that you're meeting people in your life, whether you're an activist or just a person, you know, of with interest on world views and the cabal and what's happening on our planet? Regardless, if you're tuned into this station this evening, it means that you are probably an awake being, and you're looking to meet more like-minded individuals, which is perfect because that's what we have here on the Truth Denied Talk Radio. All of the links to all of my guests, by the way, are linked up on the front page, homepage of thetruthdenied.com. And then, of course, if you ever want to see the upcoming guests, we try to keep up with our own scheduled page, and it's a little difficult. We're really booked out many, many weeks in advance now. But if you go to the schedule page, you'll see upcoming shows, and you'll also see the past shows. Anything that has been a past show that is over 24 hours old will have the links to these shows, the videos of the shows, and the articles that were presented as well. So you never lose track of a guest that you really liked, a book you wanted to purchase, a DVD, what have you. And the good news and the big news is that what is starting to happen on the planet is that we are starting to meet one another via the internet or however, and we are starting to get validated one another. We are starting to fill in gaps of our own hypothesis, if you will. Those who have been studying UFOs for quite some time are starting to really connect the dots. It's a fascinating time on the planet, and I'm digging it totally, because it just doesn't stop. Sometimes it can be absolutely overwhelming. And as our guest last week had said, be the best person you can be, tell the truth, and be of service. Don't be a self-serving, you know, mongrel like these cabal and government and CIA and all of the NSA. And speaking of the NSA, I want to give you just a little bit of an update before I bring my guest onto the show. In the midst of every other distraction, the Obama-supporting MSM reports on news about the Snowden saga, Of course, you know, Snowden blew the whistle on the NSA wide open worldwide. And it continues to filter through other agencies aiming to keep us better informed about the process. Now, Edward seeking political asylum at this point. Recent report as of the 23rd, it looks like he might be staying in Russia for good. And this is causing problems between Russia and the United States. It's quite interesting. If you read the Republic magazine, really covered it quite well. They said the ongoing Snowden saga should serve as a message to the American public, people and sheeple alike, that what the Obama Nazis in D.C. are calling espionage isn't viewed in the same light by the members of the international community. Russia should accept Snowden's request for asylum and grant him citizenship if he chooses to request such. Snowden's revelations regarding the NSA warrantless wiretapping apparatus has done very little, if anything at all, to harm the efforts of a completely dysfunctional regime. As they continue to watch the Snowden saga unfold, they said they need to keep in mind that only people that see any fault in what he has done are those that support the socialist empire of Obama and his minions. I'd like to correct them on that because I think it's more of a fascist situation personally. I don't think there's socialism going on here. I think it's fascism. Look it up. We must also keep in mind that Obama regime has provided absolutely no evidence that anything Snowden has done has damaged their disastrous attempts at thwarting terrorism here or in any other part of the world as the Snowden saga continues to grab an occasional headline. So does proof that the NSA is ill-equipped to handle any information regarding terrorists, evidenced by the hundreds of former Al-Qaeda prisoners in Iraq who recently escaped a daring jailbreak. I must say that keep an eye on the Russian, American, and Putin, Prime Minister Putin. Keep an eye on that relationship. Russian Prime Minister Putin has repeatedly stated that Snowden is a free man and that no evidence has been provided in support of the clear legal basis the Obama team has dreamed up and promoted through their MSM mouthpieces. The fact of the matter is that Snowden saga proves it. Edward is nothing more than a patriotic whistleblower who sacrificed everything normal in his life to educate the American people about the illegal activities of Obama and his boys. So they also, and we chime in, good luck and Godspeed with Snowden. So that's just an update for you. And you might want to go to the Republic magazine and check out Russian troops on U.S. soil. Go and check that article out. Again, it's Russian troops on U.S. soil. I'll drop a link into the chat room if you want to put it on the side and read it later. You know, everything is connected these days. So whether we're talking about UFOs or World War III, it all has the same transparency that's happening. We're starting to see how the world works. So without any further ado, I know you're excited to hear about these fabulous three. And a little bit of background, if I may. First of all, with Jim Kerr. Jim's a retired police officer with an extensive background in criminal investigation. So if anything, Jim Kerr knows how to do an investigation, whether it be UFO or murders, correct? So Jim works part-time in a private high-risk security along with conducting high-profile investigations and surveillance for a private investigation firm. And as of January 2011, Jim took an interest in chemtrails and began researching and videoing the skies of the Antelope Valley, California. So any of you, I know I saw a couple of you today posting from Antelope Valley. Feel free to call in the show the second hour or go ahead and put any questions that you might have in your what you're observing in your skies as well. I saw a very interesting comment of a gentleman who was saying that he was seeing in the chemtrails and a plane shooting out it didn't appear to be black chemtrails, more like black darts. And so I want to hear what these gentlemen have to say about that, if they've seen that at all. And so Jim's work is very involved. And then, of course, he hooked up with Sean Gautreaux, what is in our skies. And we'll drop all of their links. Again, they're all linked up at The Truth Tonight as well. What is in our skies is Sean Gautreaux's YouTube website. And so Sean and Jim quickly became friends and exchanged a lot of information together. So they've been doing that for quite some time now. The crafts that they are seeing seem to be so far advanced that they're beyond science fiction, is what Jim says. Could they be used for weather warfare machines, surveillance, chemtrail cloud cover, able to direct electrical charges, aka fake lightning, at any target they wish? And this is the question of the day. Some feel they do. Some feel that some of them are even extraterrestrial. This disturbing reality, Jim says, is that these craft are being documented worldwide. And folks, they're not kidding. These reports are coming in even to the Truth Denied now. The similar reports of their observations. You know, Sean's observations of the patterns surrounding these craft helped him to understand a deep underlying principle or symmetry of another kind as well. He started to see patterns, and his work is definitely, he's got a website called Industrial Surrealism. He's on YouTube. Check out the YouTube channel when we drop in the links. And of course, last but not least, and new to the show, I'm very interested in hearing what our Miss American Bunker, I love the name. She has a background in healthcare and currently resides on the West Coast, USA. Several years ago, she inadvertently stumbled across the Disclosure Project interviews on YouTube. Sherry was stunned at the testimony of so many brave, respected, vetted military and civilian men and women talking of aliens, UFOs, underground bunkers, etc. So she began to watch more whistleblower videos, but also UFO videos from around the world. And while grateful for others' efforts, Sherry was frustrated, as many of us are, with the UFO videos that had the same negative characteristics in common, like they go too fast so you can't see, it's a blur, or it's too far away to be seen. And I know we all get frustrated with that, or we say, where is it? Where is it? So she found a video software program and taught herself how to use it. So through trial and error and accident, Sherry has discovered it's sometimes possible to use basic video software options to detect high-frequency presences in the atmosphere of video footage and images. These presences include majestic craft of advanced intelligent beings, the animal-like beings that accompany such craft, and the traceable activity of both. This is amazing, folks. Several thousand videos later, Sherry is still sharing freely the knowledge she's gained and how others can easily do the same. So if you film UFOs, people, or chemtrails or whatever, and you want to get it a little bit deeper into this, Sherry can assist you with this. And that's what she does. Tonight, she's going to discuss how to detect the high frequency presences in video footage images, chemtrails, and video analysis. Alien craft has been identified chemtrailing the atmosphere in numerous videos in both the UK and Antelope Valley. Go figure. Chemtrails sometimes cloak the larger alien craft in the sky, and chemtrails sometimes are used as transport pathways for alien entities and activities. Again, we'll drop all of her links into the chat room as well. And if you forget to take them home with you, just go to thetruthdenied.com and everything is there for you. I want to welcome one by one our guests this evening. First, I'd like to say welcome back to the show, Jim Kerr. And it's so nice to have you and that you've taken the time with all your busy work lately. Welcome.
Thank you, Roxy. Thanks for having me back.
You betcha. And I look forward to hearing some of the latest stuff that's going on with you. You've got quite a lot to discuss. And then, of course, I want to welcome my pal and buddy, Sean Gautreaux. Sean, welcome to the show, and thanks again for being with us this evening.
Hey, Roxy. Thank you. Thank you. Glad to be here.
Thank you. And then, of course, new to our show, Sherry, or Miss American Bunker. Welcome to the show. I think I'll call you Sherry. Is that okay?
That's great, Roxy. Thank you so much for having me. If I can just make one correction. When people look for me on YouTube, it'll be Ms. American Bunker.
Yes.
I know there's a Miss American Bunker, but that's not
Ms. Yes. Oh, yes. That's a good one. Ms. American Bunker.
I tried for Miss, but it was taken.
So already we've got some questions coming in, and I like that first question. And Kathy in the chat room, I'm definitely going to ask that question in the next 10 minutes. So just hang in there because you're reading my mind, Kathy. So, Jim, you've got a new website, do you?
Yes, I do. It's not complete yet. You know, it's a work in progress. It's sure. chemtrailsavca.com.
Okay. That's Chemtrails, A-V-C-A, A as in Apple, V as in Victor, C as in Charlie, A as in Apple.com. And, yeah, I did take a look at it, and I'm really, you know, websites are a real chore, trust me. I remember we were building our website, and it just months and months went by, and it was just never enough. It's just amazing. But you're doing a good job, so thanks for providing the public with the information. And, we get started, I'm just going to invite Sean to comment on, you know, he and I were both copied on a letter that you sent to to NASA, I should say, and to Mr. Roland, I believe. Actually, hold that thought, Sean. Jim, why don't you just give us a brief rundown of what you said in that letter or what you asked NASA and who Mr. is at NASA?
I saw a video on YouTube, you know, where a caller had called and spoke directly to Mr. Roland, you know, who is a NASA employee that works at the NASA Gauden Space Flight Center. And, you know, she had some concerns regarding the July 4th rocket launch, you know, of the two daytime rockets that they launched spraying the lithium spray. And it was, you know, a daytime, they call it the Dynamo mission. And you know, just briefly, you know, the mission was a joint effort between NASA and the Japanese Aerospace Exploration Program, you know, and it was launching two rockets spraying lithium, and it was to study, you know, air currents and that in the atmosphere. Now, people can go to the NASA Gauden website, and they'll give all the information on that missile launch. But what I noticed when I was listening to the conversation, what struck my attention was Mr. Roland made several references to chemtrails. And, you know, he said the word, you know, specifically chemtrails, and he also stated...
Really?
Yes. In fact, you know what? I've got a real... If we can play this now... I've got a real short clip of
we
him.
We can't play it.
I didn't think
I'm
so.
I'm sorry.
That's okay, you know. But anyways, in essence, you know, he talked about chemtrails and how there's different chemtrails for different applications. Now, when I heard that, you know, it was like, you know, wow, you know, sparks started flying. You know, here we're talking about a rocket launch, you know, with lithium, you know, for checking out, you know, air currents in the atmosphere. You know, and it has something to do with auroras as well. And then he's talking about different chemtrails for different applications. So I wrote him a letter, emailed him a letter, and basically, you know, I told him about the work that I was doing. You know, hundreds of hours of video and photographs of chemtrail activity, you know, over the Antelope Valley. You know, and how you know, it didn't matter what the weather conditions were, hot or cold. You know, summer, winter. You know, these sprays, you know, you could see the jets turning on and off the spray. And I talked to him also. I explained to him about some of the other anomalies that I've seen in the sky with cloud experiments. You know, one in particular, real briefly, you know, last, in fact, it was a year ago, they created this enormous cloud in the sky. Now, and the winds reached up to 65 miles an hour that day. That cloud never moved. All day long, jets were spraying to the intake side or the upwind side of this cloud and actually spraying short chemtrails into the front of this. Out the back of this thing, it looked like the exhaust of a gasoline engine. It was pouring out cloud cover. And I'll try to make this as short as possible. I went on radar. And this cloud cover, during the course of 14 hours during the day, I monitored this cloud. the cloud cover spewed out the back of this thing. The main cloud didn't move, but the cloud cover was carried away by the winds and wound up down in New Mexico and all the way over into Arizona. So I mentioned that to him. I also, you know, I never mentioned anything in my letter about the rockets. You know, like right. I was oblivious to the rockets. I went into the triangular craft. I went into that. And then he didn't respond to me. It was actually his response was given to somebody else, to Mr. Keith Kohler, who also works at Nasser Gaden. And basically, he explained to me about the rocket launch, you know, which I never even asked about. He gave me a bunch of information, some links on the rocket launch. And then his statement here, it says, based on your description below, everything that I talked about, the types of vapor trails we use for scientific study do not fall within what you have documented. And then he referred me to the NASA website, you know, to look up aircraft vapor trails or persistent contrails. You know, so I just, you know, overall, you know, none of my questions were answered. You know, I was just referred to their website. But the thing that was strange was this conversation of different chemtrails for different applications. And he also said that you see these all the time in the sky. Now, was this a slip of the tongue?
Right.
So basically, that's the whole thing. And they did invite me, you know, Mr. Kohler invited me to contact him. He gave me his phone number and he invited me to contact him and, you know, discuss it further. And I thought about taking it one step further. I don't know if I'd be opening up a can of worms or not, but I thought about contacting him and sending him a bunch of videos, you know, and saying, can you explain this?
Well, you know, I was going to say, I'm also, if I have your permission to do so, Jim, I'm going to take the letter that you sent and the letter that you, that he sent back or his associate, and put that into a document so that the public can actually read it.
Oh, absolutely.
And, you know, if you don't mind. And we'll have that in the article for this show so that people can refer to it, because it's too long to drop this all into the chat room at the moment. But we are going to be going to break any moment. So I just want to applaud your efforts. And I, you know, I remember when you sent me the reply, I thought, wow, they responded to you fairly quickly. But I do think that you're right on the money, because the diversion that they used was the rocket program. And I do think, Jim, that you're right. I think that was a diversionary tactic for an answer, because they'd already spoken about these different chemtrail applications using the word chemtrail.
Actually using the word chemtrail several times. And
which is just mind-blowing.
It's mind-blowing. I mean, different chemtrails for different applications. And when I heard that, you know, I mean, I almost shot out of my chair.
I bet you did. And I would love to get a copy of that as well, because I'd like to get that out to the public as well, so the public can actually hear them using the word chemtrail. I mean, that's astounding, because, you know, for quite some time, and I have my theory about it, from the beginning, they were trying to get us to change the language of chemtrail to geoengineering and never use the word chemtrail again. Don't use it. Don't use it. It's not a real word. And that somebody of that level of intelligence, if you will, is using words like chemtrails. And thanks for tuning in on a Friday evening. We always appreciate it. Jim, I wanted to ask you, you know, we basically know about your relationship, you know, how you met Sean Gautreaux and in his work and finding some similarities. But and then, of course, you how you met Ms. American Bunker Sherry. So, you know, just because this show is going to fly by, the minutes are getting eaten up. Can we give the short version of it? And Sean, I'd like you to jump in at this moment, if you could, and just describe a bit about your channel and, you know, your work and some of the notes that you and Jim have compared as well. So, Sean, go ahead, and then we'll get back to Jim and Sherry.
Sure, and thank you. I've been doing this now for a little over 2 years and studying the skies. And on June 2nd, 2011, I put out the first 9 parts of the series, What is in Our Skies? And throwing it out there saying, hey, what do y'all think? And within, I'd say, under 2 weeks, Jim and I found each other, either through others saying, check out Jim's work or the other way around. And lo and behold, we were looking at the same thing. And I'm here in New Orleans, Louisiana, quite a distance away from Antelope Valley, and the same things are going on. So finding that and finding other people around the globe who have been reporting the same kind of thing has been just mind-blowing. But Jim's really good at what he does, and he's got some great equipment, and we've tracked these down pretty well, and we're talking the same story here. So it was great hooking up with Jim.
Awesome, and thanks, Sean. So, Jim, what are nanocraft?
Well, let's see. If I may, just go into a brief synopsis or explanation of nanotechnology. And all this information comes off of, most of this information comes off the NASA website. You know, anybody could go to NASA and punch in nanotechnology and pull up different articles. Now here's one article from 1998. And it basically, you know, it says here, laboratories throughout the world are rapidly gaining atomically precise control over matter, as this control extends to ever wide variety of materials, processes, and devices. Opportunities for applications relevant to NASA's missions will be created. So basically, NASA has got this. They're working on this, almost like a smart technology, nanotechnology. And they call it a swarm technology. It's called ANTS, A-N-T-S, which it stands for Anonymous Nanotechnology Swarm. Now, in their, they also get into this swarm could be used in a tetrahedron, which is a three-sided pyramid. You know, it has three sides, and the bottom is also, you know, enclosed in, you know, where they can use this nanotechnology to form any type of form. You know, here's just a, you know, this is right off of NASA's site. It says the cartoon superheroes were frustrated. They confronted a menacing robot that quickly repaired any damage they inflicted. And of course, this is just sci-fi thing. It was made up of swarm of microscopic robots, so-called nanobots, that could change its function and shape at will. Suddenly, the swarm became fluid and flowed away. And it says here, NASA invites you to consider the versatility of nanobot swarm that has abundant flexibility to change shape as needed. You know, before I even started researching into any of this nanotechnology and found these links on NASA's website, you know, I was sitting back one day and just thinking, you know, we're seeing these craft, you know, these triangular shapes. I even went back and Sean, I think, has done the same, gone back through old videos of old movies, old photographs that I've had, family photos, you know, from the 60s and 70s. And we're seeing some of these triangular shapes up there, you know, which, you know, are these occurring naturally in our atmosphere, in our world? I believe they are, you know, but I also believe, and of course this is all conjecture, you know, that somebody in the military industrial complex is creating these craft to replicate what has been in our sky, what we have seen. You know, you take, you know, some of these craft, and I think of this nanotechnology like you're driving down the road. There's a swarm of bees. Your car smacks into the swarm of bees. Okay, yes, you do kill some of these bees, but that swarm can come back together into its, you know, a massive bee swarm again after it's been hit. Now, looking at some of these craft, I have actually seen jets spray chemtrails directly through the center of some of these larger triangular objects up in the sky. Now, they're actually targeting these things with the chemtrail spray. You know, so then I started asking myself the question, you know, could this be some sort of nanotechnology? You know, could this be some sort of smart technology, nanotechnology? You know, stop and think that if, you know, they've got the science, they've got the technology, you know, with these nano machines, nanoparticles, and they even explain, you know, that they're using nanotubes, you know, with these as well. You know, they can individually form an object And then each nanoparticle has a specific job to do, you know, so you're looking at, you know, it's just, that's where I'm going with what I'm seeing with a lot of these craft.
Sure. Now, with all that in mind, and I will get into the why, because that's going to be a big question for all of you to answer, is why they're doing it. But Sherry, I'd like you to please jump in at this moment.
Sure.
What Jim is talking about, are you able to film what he's talking about? In other words, these metal particulates, are you able to prove that these metal particulates, these nanobots, nano swarms, are actually real?
With the dark particulate matter, no. But with the other chemtrail matter, yes. In fact, I have a video that Jim filmed and I analyzed right there from Antelope Valley, and it clearly, clearly shows alien craft in the sky chemtrailing. And I don't
so it's alien craft. Now this is particularly of interest, because you're not the first to say this, but very few people actually even mutter these words. Utter, I should say, these words.
Well, I wouldn't do that, Roxy, if I'm not asking
you didn't
people
know.
To believe it. There's data.
No. I believe you, actually. The analysis that you've done on this. Now let's help the public to understand something, because this is fairly new what you're talking about. First of all, you're saying chemtrailing is most likely or absolutely being done by alien craft, not human craft, not
no,
human
I'm not
technology.
I'm not saying that at all.
Oh, okay. Say that
I
again.
I see both man-made craft and alien craft chemtrailing.
So both are chemtrailing, man-made and alien.
That's what I see.
Okay. And you mentioned dark particulate matter, that you haven't been able to analyze that. Can you tell us what dark particulate matter is and why you're not able to analyze it?
You know, I don't know why, Roxy.
Wow.
And that's the truth. I really don't know why. I looked at that matter at Jim's videos, because he has a lot of that. And it's very difficult. My only guess would be it's something about the frequency. The higher frequency of matter is, the harder it is to tune in.
Okay.
And that is a guess.
Gotcha. Okay.
But everything else is seemed to be very doable.
Okay. And then what is the difference? There must be a difference between the man-made alien...
Yes.
And the alien crafts. And can you tell us what the difference is?
Sure, absolutely. I have studied over 2,000 videos, Roxy, in a high-frequency manner. And I come up with a list of commonalities. Usually, alien craft is animal-shaped. You will find that the whole craft is animal-shaped, and you will find all different animal shapes and ET shapes that these craft are built out of. In addition to that, you will find animal-shaped craft on the motherships and ET animal-shaped figures there on the craft. The only man-made craft that I believe I've been able to decloak, so to speak, is some in Antelope Valley, because it doesn't look animal-shaped. It looks more stealth-shaped. It looks more forceful, more military-like. But there's also quite a bit of alien craft right there in Antelope Valley.
That's really interesting, because a lot of people for, oh my gosh, Sherry, at least 3-4 years were reporting these animal shapes in the skies. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I would just want to ask, what's a common animal shape that you have seen?
You know, there's not like you can identify as like a humanistic type animal. There are all kinds of them. They're almost Disney-like in nature.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
They're very, very surreal and stunning. I had to look at a lot of videos before I could accept what I was seeing.
I understand. And then the other question I would have is, And you may not know the answer, but are the military working with the extraterrestrial? Does it appear that they're working together? I have three scenarios. Does it appear that they're working together up to something? Or does it appear that maybe the ET craft are cleaning up the mess that the military craft might be making? Or are they fighting?
In my opinion, Roxy, mm-hmm. okay, I believe that the military and alien off-world entities are absolutely working in conjunction with each other. It would be impossible for that not to be so with the data that we're seeing in the Antelope Valley over and over and over, and not just from Mr. Kerr's videos, but also from other independent YouTubers. I never analyzed my own videos, ever. But we're seeing the military alien presence there, and we're seeing chemtrails and occlusion of the sky. I did see, and I just posted two videos about, I think I titled it Aliens in Vague California, or Aliens in California, two at-length, in-depth videos that show they come in and start a massive thunderstorms and showers and wash the environment clean. And then they're down on the ground. I'm working on another video of the same storm. So I wonder if some do not wash the environment clean before they come, and then others are there to, you know, geoengineer it, make it more hospitable to themselves, possibly in addition to all their other nefarious activities. But I've seen what I believe to be both.
That is just fascinating. I have to ask you, how does this make you feel to discover what you're discovering right now? Does it make you feel afraid? Does it
Yes.
make you feel, does it really, can you tell me why?
Let me tell you, because Roxy, I had never had an interest in these things ever. I worked my whole life in a very science-based profession. You know, where we look for things that are replicatable, which, by the way, anybody listening can use the same simple techniques and replicate any video they see. And they can use the same techniques to use it on any video that they want to investigate. But yes, it did scare me when I first started seeing these objects. That's why I say over and over, trace the shapes, people. Don't believe me, believe the data. You know?
Yes, yes. And do people contact you to learn
yes.
how to do this? Okay. So that'll be available to the public for those who are filming and would like to know more. They'll be able to contact you.
Roxy, sure. I'm constantly available, constantly
wow.
for people. And
Thank you.
Help anybody who needs help. I've even done little videos to show them how to use the software.
Okay. Thank you so much. Thank you for that work. And you were also saying that the chemtrails actually cloak larger alien craft. Now,
yes.
With that in mind, the chemtrail is that's cloaking the alien craft. Do you know if the chemtrails man-made, military, or another ET that's cloaking a craft?
When I've seen the alien craft cloaked, normally that's a darn good question, Roxy, because sometimes I see the alien craft cloaking the area, and sometimes I don't, but I'll see the alien craft, I'll be able to decloak it, so to speak, and know there's an alien craft there, but I don't necessarily see an alien craft spraying the chemicals. But we
okay.
definitely do in Jim Kerr's videos.
Okay. And now I'm just going to pop in a couple of questions from our audience. Izzy is asking, do you mean, and she's talking to you, Sherry, do you mean the animal-shaped clouds are UFOs? I have often said the sky is being brought to us from Disney. The sky is consistent in its shapes. So she's asking, are you saying that the animal-shaped clouds are the UFOs?
Sometimes they are.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You have to do the very simple process, and it takes me less than a minute, Roxy, to know if this is an alien craft, just running it through software.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Many times these animal shaped clouds are alien craft, and I do the Disney connection. There is a Disney NASA connection also, and where people question if Walt Disney did not get some of his ideas for these characters from NASA.
Mm-hmm.
So
that's interesting. Oh, wow. That's really interesting.
Yeah, people
wow.
can Google that. Just Google NASA Walt Disney connection.
And yes, okay. And then I will get back to another question, a couple questions that I do have for you. One more, Sherry, for you, and sure. Then I'm going to hop over to Sean. You would also mention that chemtrails are used, sometimes used as transport pathways for alien entities' activity. Can you explain that for us?
Absolutely. I'll try to do as simple as I can. And once again, this is why I want people to look at the video that Jim Kerr filmed and I analyzed, because you will see it in this video. There are other ones too, but that's the one that comes to mind. Chemical, anything in the sky is etheric, Roxy. It's etheric, intelligent matter capable of transporting not only moisture like a cloud, but chemicals and entities, high frequency entities as well. It's very simple.
So
did that make sense?
Well, I'm not as scientific as you, but it doesn't matter. For instance, let me give you an example. Sometimes I have filmed clouds being colored in as I'm filming them very quickly. A big white cloud that was appearing to be a chemtrail sprayed from a plane, and then I'll watch it and it will start to color itself in. Blues, reds, greens, yellows, as if somebody was coloring in a coloring book. And it'll get brighter and brighter, and then eventually it'll dissipate. Other times we have reports, and of course I've seen it, we've all seen it, when the moon is out, sometimes we'll see a spraying going on, chemtrail spraying at night, and then there'll be sort of this, because of the light of the moon reflecting off the sun, we are able to see these colored, what appears to be like an oily sky full of color directly around and in front of the moon. Is this what we're talking about?
I think that would be the chemtrail coloring.
Okay.
But not necessarily, not craft, as far as I would know.
Well, but I guess I'm referring to be more specific, is that chemicals floating in the atmosphere, and we're just able to see them. They're prisming somehow off of light, and we're able to see.
Well, okay. There's also a scientist. Her name is Sujoy Renison out of the UK, and she speaks about the magnetic fields of the Earth changing, and this is why some people are now able to see things that they weren't able to see, and possibly why our technology, our simple technology of camcorders or whatnot, are able to record this now, whereas maybe before they weren't able to do so because we have
the spectrum of light.
Pardon me, Roxy?
The spectrum of light that's available to us via digital recorders or that we're able to get up closer to it, or the infrared filming.
The magnetic fields are changing, and that's what I took away from that. I'm not sure about the spectrum of light. I know the magnetic fields have changed, and I believe that has something to do with the technology and the camcorders. Although I'm sure we're picking up more spectrums of light, but for me, it has something to do more with magnetism, which I don't understand completely, Roxy.
Okay. No, that makes sense to me, and thank you, Sherry. Thank you for being so brave and courageous to even bring forward, this evidence. I mean, I really appreciate it. I do have a question for everyone on the panel, and I'm going to start with Sean. I'll come back around to Sherry as well. Of course, one of the things I want to know is Sean and Jim, if you are seeing the same and filming the same things that Sherry is describing. So, Sean, are you resonating with what Sherry is talking about?
Absolutely. I've been sitting here just listening to this, and I'm like, this falls right in line with what I've been looking at for 2 years. And I'll tell you why. Nanotechnology, going back to Jim. Nanotechnology has been something that's been in my head for quite some time when it came to these craft. And I have kind of a background in it, in that I know 3D printing and I know the origins of nanotechnology. And when you break it down simply, nanotechnology is the ability to take one atom or one molecule and place it next to another and hold it steady in that way. And once you do that, you can do essentially anything. And originally, the concepts were to create small motors with molecules, knowing their relations and being able to place them together. So yeah, I think that's definitely connected with what they've got going on up above. Another thing I thought about early was the addition of the possibility of aluminum in this, and what, let's say, this nanotechnology was using the aluminum to make the frame of a virtual craft. Not a full fighter or a plane, but just the frame of it, and how would that work? But going on animals, one of the things I photographed even before I got into filming in infrared, I would see these streams coming across over the lake from north to south, and I would call them the animal parade. Because when they'd come by, it seemed like a bunch of animals, almost like a circus in a way. And yeah, they'd make a bunch of different shapes. And I remember in one of my earlier videos, I was talking about shapes that look like fish or dolphins or crawfish. So yeah, to me, it was an animal parade in a way. Also going on about color. Yeah, definitely. This chemical sky is producing different colors. This is not normal. This is not just regular moisture or water. Whatever they're spraying up above is producing, you know, different colors, and it's not your typical rainbow spectrum. So yeah, everything that's been said so far is definitely falling in line with this, and we're talking about the same thing.
We're talking about the same thing. Okay. And Jim, you know, how do you feel about what's been said so far and what Sherry has been able to pull from videos, et cetera? How do you feel about it? And are you also experiencing the same thing? Does this resonate with your work?
Yes, it does. You know, when I first saw Sherry's work, which was probably about 7 months ago, you know, I wasn't skeptical, you know, because I've always had an open mind, you know, especially when, you know, what I consider you're delving into the supernatural realm. You know, I've got an open mind to pretty much anything, you know, and, you know, I was following her work, looking at her videos, and, you know, I was starting to see what she was talking about. You know, I could see these figures, I could see these alien-like, cartoonish-like figures, and I could see, you know, where she would point out how they're being transported down to the ground. Now, here's what, I mean, this is what totally blew my mind. You know, and some time ago, a long time ago, you know, Sherry asked, you know, if I could, you know, if she could analyze any of my videos. I said, you know, anything I've got is yours, you know, go for it. And, you know, I've got this one video from a year ago, from September 9th of 2012, you know, where, I mean, there was a lot of activity going on. I mean, there's so much going on overhead that, you know, it's hard to discern who is who. You know, we could get into that later. But, you know, in this video footage, you know, it starts off with a rod coming down between my house and my workshop. You can see this rod coming down. And then, you know, I was filming, you know, some lightning, which I believe had to do with craft lightning, because you could see the craft in the sky, a triangular object, you know, with the lightning bolts coming out the back. So she analyzes footage, and on the stucco wall of my shop, she, you know, which was in the video, and when she did the frequency changes and the lighting.
Top of the second hour, we will, again, like I said, be answering your questions as fast as we can. There's just so much ground to cover here with these fine guests that we have this evening, Jim Kerr, Ms. American Bunker, we are calling her Sherry, and Sean Gautreaux. So, you know, you were just in the middle of something, Jim, the story, and I'm hanging here. I want to know. I want to know the rest of the story, what happened when you something filming against the wall, you were saying, or something behind the wall, or
in her analyzing of this video, you know, on the wall, in the middle of, you know, these lightning bolts coming down, you know, craft up there, you know, a rod shooting through the scene and all this, here's this image on my wall that she was able to pull out. And I believe I sent you photos of that image. That it's like, I mean, it's plain as day. Here's this green reptilian-like creature, entity on all fours, you know, sitting, you know, and there again, I don't know if he was on the wall, projected on the wall, but it's plain as day, this green reptilian creature on all fours. Now, behind him, there is a building. You could see the framework of what looks like a old Spanish-style church with an arched opening doorway in the front. You could see the roof line. I mean, a perfect image of this building. The building also has a tower that might be a bell tower or something like that. And out of the doorway, the arched doorway, there's this white gaseous like material coming out. But plain as day, here's this reptilian creature that, you know, an artist looked like it painted this thing on the side of my wall. I mean, I was totally blown away. I mean, you know, that and you know, there, you know, my perception of this is that this was an interdimensional creature, you know, whether it be, you know, and obviously in my perception, a demonic entity, you know, that came into our dimension. You know, and of course, my wife and I prayed about it and everything else. In fact, I still walk outside my shop and, you know, I've given her an eviction notice to get off of my property. You know, every time I walk out, I tell her to get out of there. But I mean, this was mind blowing. I sent you some photos on that.
Yes, I have them. And I'll add those into the video of the show and the article as well. I was just not able to use the link. You requested I not use the link, so I don't have any ability to get those into the chat room.
But I'm so sorry.
No, that's okay. Don't even worry about it, Jim. We will get it out to the public in light of this entire conversation, where it'll actually make sense. But you know, during the break, we were all discussing. I like what you both were talking about, Sean and Sherry, about the grid. Sherry, can you repeat what you repeated during the break about a grid and layering a grid and how that's done in medicine as well?
Sure. When in medicine, when you want to treat a wound bed, what you try to create is an electrolytic grid on that wound bed. And there are ways to doing that. Usually you'll put down some type of gel and you hope to create electrolytic grid for the skin cells to attach to and to grow and to build up. But you could actually control where those skin cells grow on that grid if you wanted to. So it's just interesting to create a grid, you know, where we can create those grids, be it in the sky or in a wound bed or wherever we choose to do that.
That is fascinating because it makes it very relative. And if I may, Sean, you were talking about color because you're an artist. Can you repeat what you were saying, the three colors and the distinctions and why you arrive at the certain answers that you arrive at simply based on color?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, color is my thing, and it always has been. I'm an artist, and if there's one thing I know, it's color. And one of the first things I noticed with the particulate in the sky was the types of colors that we have. And we are trained to think that moisture, cloud material is white, and essentially it is. But these other colors started showing up, and this wasn't infrared or anything special. It was just looking at regular video. So I can discern white moisture from a silvery material, which seems like it's being sprayed down via the tankers. There's also like a dirty, brownish, yellowish, rusty material in the clouds, and there's also a bluish, darker material that seems to point to the exhaust of the craft. And when I see this darker, bluer material, and I say bluer in relation to the other colors, it usually points to the back ends of the craft, and that's what they're spewing out, is this darker, bluish material. So it's
that makes
pretty obvious. Yeah.
Yeah, that makes sense. And I've seen those photos as well, not just from all of you, but from the public. So and some videotapes, and I've filmed most of what you've just described as well. But I like that you say it's getting pretty obvious because you're being able to discern the difference. Here's what I think most people want to know about. I think the number, you know, the million-dollar money question, man, is why are they doing this? what's the intent behind it? Now, I know that you're probably all going to have a different answer for this. So, Sean, continue. I want to know what you think in your best estimation, if these are ET with man-made craft, if they're doing something together, they're working together on something, if indeed they're building some kind of a grid, if indeed, like what Jim had said, that these are, you know, this is nanomaterial, self-replicating, nanobots, nanotechnology, apparatuses being used to spray smart dust, and all the rest of it. Or the swarm technology. Why are they doing it?
I really still don't know. I honestly don't. And, you know, one day I'll wake up and I'll say, this is all military. And the next day I'll wake up and I'll say, well, maybe there's the possibility of ET technology. And for me, doing this only 2 years now, I don't have the background knowledge to really say, this is what it is. But I can say this is maybe what it is. And I just keep on pointing back to different references over the years, people that have come out and said something, and maybe it connects to this, maybe it connects to that. And I often think of quotes from Bob Dean, Bill Uhouse, Paul Hellyer, and a lot of what they say fits into whatever agenda this is. And I'll just say it's not beneficiary. It's something, it's deception. It's, I don't know exactly what's going on, but if I had to bet money, I would say that yes, we have had technologies, in the last 60 years that have benefited via alien, or gray, agenda technologies. And what is the end result? I don't know, but it's not looking too good. So.
So you don't feel that it's something that's benevolent. You feel more like it's something darker agenda, and that it's probably not a good thing.
Yes, that's okay. What I think.
And, that's fair. And
I hate to go down the doom route, but the fact that the deception is there alone is telling me that deception's not good, and we're being deceived for a reason. What that reason is, I don't know yet, but I think we're getting there.
Okay, I understand. And Jim, your thoughts as well, why and what are they doing?
Well, you know, if you, for me, if you connect all the dots of all the researchers over the years, everybody from Jack Vallée to Norio Hayakawa, then you connect all the stories that we've heard, you know, from whistleblowers that come out, you know, Bob Lazar, you know, and we're talking a wide spectrum of people over the years. You know, we've all heard all the stories. What we're seeing up there, I perceive, is a multitude of different players, different activity. You know, we've got players from the military-industrial complex, you know, the interdimensional activity, you know, and, you know, I'm going to go back to the Bible, and I hope nobody turns off their station. I'm not going to beat anybody over the head with a Bible. I'm not a Bible thumper, but you go back, if you do some serious research, you know, starting from Genesis chapter 1, and especially through the Old Testament, and a lot in the New Testament refers back to the Old Testament, confirming things. You know, the bottom line is the first thing you've got to do is you have to believe the first sentence in chapter 1 of Genesis. God created, you know, the heaven and the earth. You've got to believe that. And a lot of this comes from faith, okay? More than just faith, in my situation and a lot of other people's situation, it comes from supernatural things that have happened to you over the course of your lifetime, you know, and I'm talking there's no time to go into a lot of things right now, but supernatural events that have happened to you that there's no other possible explanation than intervention from a supernatural being, whether it be good or evil, you know, whether it be one of God's holy angels or God's fallen angels, you know, so, you know, you go through that and, you know, I encourage people to do their own research on that. You know, we're looking at, I believe we're looking at a combination of military industrial complex technology mixed in with alien technology, which in reality is fallen angel technology.
Well, and there are a lot of people that agree with you there. I mean, there are a lot of researchers, big name researchers, that agree with that concept. And, you know, we're also moving into the age of, you know, we are looking back at what we thought was quote unquote mythologies or just storytelling for the times. And we're starting to find that a lot of things are, we're discovering them. And so I can appreciate your stance, you know, on what you're saying. I can appreciate where you're coming from, because if indeed we call them fallen angels or alien beings or greys or archons or reptilians, whatever the case may be, whatever they're called, I think it's fair to say that the relationship to man and anyone who reports abduction, etc., like Whitley Strieber, will say it wasn't a fun time.
No.
So whatever these beings are, they don't seem to be light beings or love beings or happy beings.
Absolutely not.
So, I mean, there's just, you're absolutely correct, Jim. There's so much literature and history written on call them whatever you want to call them.
Exactly.
Okay. I can agree with that. So you're saying there's a mixture, and do you also feel, is this for depopulation or the control of the population of the world, Agenda 21 type of stuff, with, you know, the UN summit hearing, is this, you know, what is it? Or is there multiple reasons and multiple programs all serving some sort of separate agenda from the other?
You know, I believe everything is tied together.
Okay.
You know, we're seeing, everything that's written in Agenda 21, you know, this is all for depopulation of the planet. It's for control. You know, the control is the big thing, control of the populace. You know, everything from GMO foods to, you know, we could go on and on. We all know, you know, what the different players are, you know, and this whole thing is about control, about takeover. You know, we're talking, genetic manipulation, you know, and ultimately, you know, from a biblical standpoint, you know, it's Satan pulling his last card. You know, I mean, it's.
Well, and people say that it's the cabal or the New World Order or the elite or the Illuminati or the secret societies, you know, all come pulling together as well, pulling their last card. And that's why I've asked. Specifically, even if this is the case, if this is sort of an end game being played out, I still want to know, you know, and Sherry, maybe you can comment. I still want to know, is there a war going on up there in our skies, in our atmosphere, in our stratosphere, in our ionosphere, or is there a war against humans? That's what I want to know. Is there a war? Are they trying to kill us? Does anybody know? And Sherry, what's your take on it?
Well, I'm pretty much with Jim on this one from what I've been seeing and what I've read. And what's very interesting, I'm glad you asked that, Eden Veterans Today has come out with quite a few articles lately. And they came out with one about terraforming the Earth. And they mentioned exactly what Jim is talking about, the belief in a Luciferian a Lucifer, and geoengineering the Earth to get rid of the human population, to control them, and to ready the environment for their presence.
So are they – okay, so when you say ready the environment and terraforming, and those of you who do not understand the knowledge, what it means, terraforming, go to the Truth Denied, put in the search engine terraforming. I've got some great work on that. But regardless – terraforming for another species, and that species isn't human. Is that correct?
That's correct according to this Operation Cloverleaf, which was a United States government report, and also the secret of the Iron Mountain report. That's what they say.
Iron Mountain. Mm-hmm.
And it's on, I can send you the link here, to Secret Space War 4, Terraforming. It's on the Veterans
Yes,
Today.
I'd love to have that, and I'd love to put that in the article as well so people can take a look at that. Thank you, Sherry. So at the end of the day, people, all of you, I appreciate you coming forward. I appreciate your work, and I appreciate that you're, you know, very fair in your answers. None of you are, you know, oh, absolutely this and absolutely that. But when you do put your foot down about something, you're pretty adamant about it. And I appreciate that. But I want to know something else. If indeed the clock is ticking for humans, how do we stop them from doing this, or are we not ever going to be able to stop them? What's our destiny here? I mean, where are we going with this? If they're here terraforming our planet into a place, now people say even GMOs are changing the DNA. What if part of the food culture, what if part of the air, what if, has anybody thought that there's a possibility that they could terraform and we could all live in one place? Jim, go ahead and take that.
I don't think so. You know, we're, you know, just, you know, based on, you know, my beliefs, you know, I mean, we are created, you know, by God in His image. And there again, you know, the story's laid out through the entire Bible, exactly what we're talking about. I'm sorry, go ahead.
But no, I'm sorry. I just had to say, what if God is an alien?
Well, you know what? You could say he is. I mean, he is a supernatural being. I mean, he is the supernatural being. I mean, you know, we're people don't realize, you know, the power that God's creation has. You know, he created the angels, gave them free will, just like we have free will. We've got total free will. He created these angels. Now, one third of them fell from heaven. Right, Lucifer took one third of them to heaven by their own, you know, I mean, and the whole mission, you know, their whole mission was to go against God, you know, to change man's DNA. I mean, that's what happened in the Old Testament. You know, that's exactly what happened. You know, with
like
Genesis
a transhumanism
6.
Type
exactly,
thing.
Exactly. Okay. And you know, see, and you know, how are they doing that? You know, how is this being happened? We're seeing right before our eyes how it's happening with technology today, right? We're seeing how everything revolves around DNA, you know, changing DNA, the super soldiers, everything else, you know,
yes.
And it all goes back to biblical times, you know, and, you know, where this was an attack against God's creation, you know, to bring down man. You see, these fallen angels, they hate us. I mean, they loathe us. Why? Because we are held higher than they
are. Why
is
our kind? Why is humankind working with them if they hate us? I don't understand.
Because they've been deceived. See, that's the whole thing. That's all.
So
part
they
of
might be point. Thinking they're doing something good,
exactly.
And they're
well,
buying into a whole. Agenda of or is it possible, and Sean, maybe you can comment on this, or is it possible that beings from other worlds have always been here and been in place in Rome, you know, in the Roman Empire all the way through or whatever in Asia, and are in our government, and that they are the ones controlling government and the powers and hence, they are the powers that be and always have been. Is that a possibility that we are seeing this, Sean?
I guess. I don't have the background knowledge to really comment on too much of this. And I have been able to go back and start looking back into the Bible for answers and the Book of Enoch and things like that.
Yeah, that's a good one. The Book of Enoch is something that a lot of ufologists look at because it really describes it.
Yeah, yeah. But I'll tell you what, I don't trust the powers that be. I don't trust the government. I don't trust the ones who are in power at all. I don't think they've got our best interests in mind.
Mm-hmm.
And I think something needs to be done about that pretty quickly. Mm-hmm. And I think that's maybe a topic for another show. But if all of them were arrested and held for answers, I'd say that's a good thing.
Is it possible that we actually have reptilian beings in government? You know, I mean, is that – or in the power positions of the world? I mean, I suppose anything's possible, but, you know, it's interesting. And is it – everybody, question for everybody here. Is it even possible that we are actually evolving as humans and that they know it? And we are actually becoming smarter, wiser, more aware, more awake, and perhaps they don't want that. And is it possible that with enough of us, we can actually shift the planet and really actually win the planet over and continue? Because if you're going to mention Bible, Jim, it does talk about this. It talks about the the apocalypse, and then it talks about this 1,000 years of just happiness that we experience once. So, I mean, if we're in this sort of thing, aren't we going to win anyway?
Absolutely, mm-hmm. Absolutely. You know, it. You know,
how are we going to win?
Well, the world is not going to be destroyed. You know, to the point, you know, where. You know, God promises in Revelations that there'll be a new heaven and a new earth. So even if all these things unfold, which I believe they are going to unfold, you know, there will be a new heaven and a new earth.
So how do you get people to participate if they're atheists or they don't really believe or they're on a spiritual path that doesn't include this sort of thinking, but they're good people? I mean, is unification key to a tipping point where we can actually get to the place that we need to be in our human evolution?
I believe so, you know, but it's going to be a tough road because you know, there's, you know, how do you unify? You know, you can't beat everybody over the head, you know, and show them what God has laid out in the Bible.
But prophecy says that we will win. So
absolutely,
why not just unify? And I understand what you're saying. Don't we need to be stronger than that on the front lines, though? Don't we need to just beyond a shadow of a doubt know and just move accordingly?
Absolutely, and that's one of the biggest problems right now. And even in the Christian community, even in, you know, in the church, you know, Christians don't, and Christians, even non-Christians, don't have the tools at their disposal to carry out that mission, to carry out that word, to tell
people.
Well,
because dogma is you know, unfortunately, dogma is limited.
Right.
You know, man-made dogma is limited. But again, we are evolving, and I think that's why a lot of people are evolving away from the church and away from dogma. But let's do this. Let's get back to this whole idea that there is a possible war in our skies, or there's a war against humans. It seems to be coming out in everything. I mean, any of the big announcers and radio shows and so forth and documentaries seem to be culminating enough evidence, you know, even the Alex Joneses, you know, enough evidence to say that we are actually as humans getting bombarded. And I know, you know, with everything from electromagnetic fields to smart meters to this nano dust that we're breathing into our lungs, and all of this metal that we're putting into our bodies, and the horrible food, water, you know, everything that we have taken for granted and that used to be ours as humans is really being taken away from us and toxified and is killing us. So when we're speaking of these craft, back to these craft that are in the sky, what's the next step in this journey as far as all of your work? We're going to take a quick break. We've got one coming up any second, so I don't want any of you to start. When we come back, I want to start with Sherry. I want to know where, so think about it during the break, but where is the work going? What more is there to be revealed? So just think about that with your own work. And how long will you be continuing to do the work that you do? Is this a lifetime thing for all of you? Is this it? You know, because each and every one of you have something very interesting. You each gave up a certain life and lifestyle and just sort of moved into this. And thanks again for tuning in on a Friday evening. I know a lot of you listen on your drive home from work, and so we really appreciate you even in the car with your iPods. I was going to say, if you do decide that you want to donate at freedomslips.com, we so appreciate it. I want to thank all of you who have, all of our listeners and the great listener support that we do have. So you would go to freedomslips.com to donate to keep me on the air. And hey, I want to thank you because you've kept me on the air for over a year now. So I really do appreciate it. And Revolution Radio has really come a long way because of all of you. So I just want to say thumbs up and thank you very much. And I wanted to answer one of your questions from the chat room as well that was asked earlier. You wanted to know if I or any of my guests had contacted the local or national news stations about the subject matter, and if so, which ones? I don't know what you mean about contacted regarding which part, UFOs or chemtrails. So, Katie, if you want to repost that question, I might be able to answer it. Have I been on national news? Yes, I have. Reporting chemtrails is what I've done. Yes, I have. I've been interviewed on national CBS News, as a matter of fact. So I don't know about my guests, but we'll ask them when we get around to each one of them if they have also been to any national or local news. And Katie, if you want to make your question more poignant, I'll try to ask that question again. If you mean particularly UFOs, chemtrails, the whole agenda, whatever. So Sherry, I promised that I would start with you. Where's the work going from here, and what's the goal?
I'm slowing down, Roxy. Right now, there are hundreds of videos on Ms. American Bunker on YouTube that people can view. And I'll probably go more to helping people out that need help with it, you know, learning how to use their software or whatever, and doing, you know, occasional videos. I normally will look at gyms. I'm kind of slowing down right now, though, Roxy.
And is there a reason for that? Do you just kind of feel like your work is complete and now you can help other people do it and take a little bit of a break? Or
no, you know what it is? It's so draining. It's emotionally draining because I was never into this. I have never even seen most, science fiction movies. The only one I've ever seen is Alien. I've never seen E.T. I've never seen any of them. And when I went down the rabbit hole and I started discovering this stuff, it's like everything you ever believed is no more. And so I'm trying to find a new normal, and it's 2 years later, and I still don't have one.
Understood. I can hear it in your voice as well. You're looking for a new normal. And I just want you to know, Sherry, that I've had many a conversation with people, and I've even had those thoughts for myself. I completely understand. I cover hundreds of topics and go down rabbit holes just like you do, Sherry. And it is draining, and I find myself sometimes having panic attacks and saying, where did my life go? So exactly. I complete, right?
Yeah. Exactly.
Okay, where did my life go, and how did I get here? I already feel like I am, like I went in a spaceship and landed on another planet already. But so you're not alone in that, and a lot of whistleblowers and those who are out in the world presenting truth and fact, it is very taxing, and so I can certainly appreciate it, and I understand, and I think that the listeners will completely understand it as well. But let me say thank you for the work that you have done.
Oh, you're so welcome, and thank you for your work too, Roxy.
You betcha. I mean, I might take the technology up on cloning. I think I need like four more of me. Maybe if we can get clones, we could do this still. Yeah. But no, I appreciate that, Sherry. And Jim, what about for you? Is this just the beginning of a new dawn, or is this, are you doing this? Are you like this oath keeper frontline person that's going to just, this is what you're doing for the rest of your life? You're in it to win it. Where are you at?
Well, I understand exactly where Sherry's coming from, you know, because I've had the same thoughts myself. You know, in fact, there was a time here several months ago, I deleted over half of my videos that I had on YouTube, you know, because I just felt it wasn't getting the exposure. You know, people weren't really waking up to everything. You know, so it does get frustrating. I know exactly what you're talking about. Many times it gets frustrating. But, you know, I'm going to continue, but I'm probably going to maybe, you know, go off in a couple different directions. You know, one direction is going to be I'm going to start doing documentary videos on how everything we're seeing relates, you know, and we're not going into a church atmosphere or anything like that, you know, no man's religion, but how what I'm seeing relates to what is written in the Bible, you know, from Genesis to Revelations, you know, and put it into simple English, you know, so people can understand it. You know, just to get another, just to get a biblical, I'll say godly perspective to what we're seeing in the sky. You know, the other avenue I'm going to take is, you know, I want to, you know, support, you know, Sean in all of his future projects, you know, with Jose Escamilla, you know, and, you know, I've told Sean many times, any footage that I have, you know, he's more than welcome to use, you know, and, you know, I have no problem with that. You know, I've, you know, and we didn't even get into the subject of the alternate UFOs that I've captured spraying material over the city and stuff like that. But, you know, I've got a lot of footage that would apply to what Sean is doing, you know, so I want to continue to support him in that. And also for Sherry, too, you know, even if I don't post videos, I'll give her the videos to analyze or whatever, you know, so I'm not going to drop out of this. I'll still, you know, I've got too much invested. I got too much camera equipment to invest to quit, you know, everything from the, you know, I've got, you know, five different video cameras from, you know, full spectrum, the infrared, you know, and plus the DSLRs that are modified, you know, so I got too much equipment to quit. But
talk about when you've got the Nikon D2XS or D700, which one do you have?
Well, I've got a Nikon D2XS, a D700, some D200s, D70s, you know, and some of them are modified for different things, you know, for different, and I've found that a lot of these craft that we're seeing in the sky, you know, like, you know, the photo I showed you of that one strange UFO spraying over the city of Palmdale, you know, this dark material that was coming out of it. It's not a plane. It's not a bird, you know, excellent photo capture of this thing. You know, it was captured on a DSLR. I think it was the D700, you know, at a high frame rate, you know, whereas on video, you know, a lot of these things can't be captured on regular video, you know, because the frame rate is so slow. You know, you actually need, you know, for some of the stuff, you need a high speed, you know, 100,000-hour high speed camera to capture some of the stuff that are moving so fast. You know, but fortunately with the DSLR, you know, with you know, higher ISO settings and that, you know, you can capture some of these craft up there, and the thing is they're repeatable. You know, on different days I'll capture the exact same looking craft. You know, so it's not like a one time capture where it's some sort of anomaly. But so that's pretty much where I'm going to, you know, I'm headed. You know, I'm still going to, you know, post some stuff on video, you know, on YouTube and the documentaries, you know, looking from a biblical standpoint and supporting Sean. You know, I mean, I you know, and also with Sherry, too. You know, so that's, you know, I'm going to continue, you know, down that path.
Sure. It sounds good. Sounds good. Thanks for all your work, and thanks for taking a stance on what you do as well. And, you know, really putting together, you know, thanks for everything that you sent me prior to this show on all the YouTube links and what they're all about. You know, we're definitely going to put all of this into the article so that people can take a look at more of what you do as well. So I can really appreciate that, man. Thanks.
I also forgot to mention, I'm going to continue to support you as well.
So. Oh, gee, thanks.
Absolutely. You're in there with Sean and Sherry.
There you go. Thank you. Oh, no, that's thank you so much. And Sean, what about you? Is this like, you know, Sherry mentioned a 2-year. Jim, how long have you been filming? 2 years?
2 years.
And then, Sean, you've been filming for 2 years.
Yeah, just
okay. That's bizarre that you all started 2 years ago.
I don't think it started showing up 2 years ago. I think we started noticing it 2 years ago. I think this has been going on for longer.
But that you guys all started filming 2 years ago at the same time. Like Jim didn't say he's been doing this for 20 years, and Sherry didn't say 15 years. You all said 2 years. I think that's very synchronistic. So. 2 years of filming hundreds of hours of film, and then you've got the Jose Escamilla film coming up, and then what gives after that? Where are you going with this? Are you going to continue to film skies? I know that you mentioned a couple of times that you've got so much footage, there's really no reason to put up another camera, and then you change your mind and say, God, maybe there's something more. So where are you going with all this?
I have to continue. You know, as much as I'd like to go back and say, I can forget about all of this and go back to my regular life, I can't. Because if I were to even try, I would always be thinking of what's going on up above. And so I've got to keep going. And as frustrating as it is, once you know, you know. And once you have your mission, you can't deny it. So I've got to keep going. And what I've kind of shifted from... was showing my own videos, and I've said from the beginning, you know, you can look at my video once and I'll show you something, or twice, or 1,000 times, and then you'll get it and you'll see the same anomaly over and over and over. I put up a lot, you know, what, 50 videos or 60 videos at this point. But right now I'm going back to some of the stuff that I discovered in the summer of 2011, which was the NASA satellite photographs. And once I saw something in the sky and I realized, okay, I'm looking at these things real close, I went for another angle, and that angle was via NASA or just any kind of satellite photographs. And I started looking at those and figuring out there's some pretty large triangles up above as well. And I kind of set that aside for a while until I really kind of explored what was going on about 200 feet above my house. But at this point, I'm going back to the NASA satellite photographs, because once you compare the visual spectrum imagery with the thermal imagery, and it's pretty darn
easy. It's there.
Yeah, it's there. It's picking out the big ones. They're there.
How big are the big ones?
2.4 miles.
Craft that are 2.4. Are they bringing people here or aliens here and dumping them off or something? What do they need something that big for?
I don't know. And at first, I really couldn't believe it. I knew what I was seeing close up, but to see it via satellite, I'm like, there's no way.
Could
but
this
after
be
exploring this after 2 years? It's like, okay, I can deal with this.
Could this be the dark matter that Sherry was talking about earlier?
It could be.
Sean?
Yes.
Can I just interject for 1 second?
Absolutely.
Please excuse the interruption. I have a lot of moon videos on my channel. And what I did was I took somebody's moon footage that they filmed with a telescope, and then I used my computer as another telescope to really zoom in on it. And I show black craft flying off of the moon. There's black craft. They're not necessarily triangular shape where I can make out a good, great form, but you can see the craft. You can see them flying out.
Do you think that in relative to how big the moon is in your photos, does this sound like it could be the same craft? Do you think these are like a couple of miles wide?
Are you referring to me, Roxy?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, you know what? See, that's the thing. I have no way of telling how long something is or how wide it is or how fast it's moving with the way I analyze videos.
Okay.
See, Sean is like way ahead of me on that. I have no idea how he, you know, does that kind of stuff.
So okay, that's good input. You're not the first. Have you ever seen anything like that as well, Sean? Craft coming off the moon?
I've only recently started photographing the moon with the new camera, but I'll tell you what, when I saw Jose Escamilla's Celestial, I saw some things in there that looked really familiar. Okay.
Yeah, I'm glad you guys are
real big.
Bill Bryson is the same thing. And I'm, of course, you know, real interested to see some of that stuff because this isn't the first we heard of that. But I think the technology and people like yourselves all coming together and networking with what you're doing in footage, I think it just brings it to a whole nother level of transparency. I'm sure of it.
Yeah, we're getting there bit by bit, and shows like this are really helping out and connecting with Jim and Sherry. Sherry, first of all, I haven't had the chance to say your videos kick butt. I mean, you've really got a special technique there. And for the listeners out there, it seems what Sherry's doing is if you're familiar with Photoshop and the glowing edges filter, whatever filter she's using are picking out the glowing edges, are picking out the sharp edges. And this is the way I identify the craft up above. I can see their shape. And once you go to the sharp edges, that's how you pick them out. So, yeah, what you're doing is extremely valid. I've been checking out your videos over the last few days especially. And, yeah, you're on it. So keep on going.
Thank you, so much.
It's interesting that – you know, you work in graphics, and it'd be interesting to see other people who work in graphics, other graphic artists that actually know what you're talking about and know the programs that you're using and this and that, because, you know, they also could zoom in on what you guys are expressing quicker, you know what I mean, because they know the language you're using.
Yeah, and once you take these photographs or videos and you start stretching them, and really analyzing them and applying filters to them, as long as the filter applied affects every pixel equally, to me, it's valid. And that's what Sherry's doing.
Exactly.
And and it's working out pretty darn well. So yeah, I love what you're doing.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, maybe we can
be doing this longer.
Yeah, I was just going to say, hey, maybe we can keep Sherry at the picnic a little longer.
But you know, it's a great thing when you have people who are willing to share information in an open manner and are open to other people's ideas. You know,
I'm seeing more and more of that. And you're making a really, you know, underline that statement, because that is what's getting us forward. You know, the ego getting kind of put aside and not afraid to share work with one another. And like what you just said, open-mindedness, you know, I'm working on a project. I'm not at liberty to discuss it right now, but these are the types of people I'm working on the project. There's no arguing. There's so much open-mindedness. And because of it, we've just really grown and grown and grown in the project. I mean, it just moves forward so quickly when people are just willing to like let it all flow and let it all go. So I'm really, me personally, I'm glad that Jim and Sherry and Sean, you know, I'm glad that you guys have gotten together. And I love, Sean, that you're encouraging Sherry in Sherry's language, because I think, you know, Sherry has been drained. And Sherry, I have a funny feeling that you're going to be delivering some pretty awesome work coming up here, more awesome than you already have. I just have a funny feeling. We'll just keep inviting you to the show. How's that?
Okay, I'll keep coming.
Okay, there you go. Right. And so, Sean, you know, in light of that, so you had this 2.5 mile craft that's up there, and you're verifying it on satellite, so it's totally you know, real. It's no longer a hypothesis. It's there. And what are they doing? We don't know. But I have to ask you. I just can't let this show go without asking somebody this question. So it's going to be you, Sean. What about Project Bluebeam?
Yes.
What if this is none of it's extraterrestrial? What if all of this is a show of false faux alien invasion so that the New World Order can all join the entire planet together so we can all be one government and one people and shake hands with our alien friends when they come to land. Is that possible?
Very possible. And for me, it's still on the table. Absolutely. I've kind of gone through this whole thing, and yeah, if I wanted to build, let's say it's a balloon, let's say it's a Zeppelin, and I want to build it 2.4 miles across, feasible, very feasible. And if you wanted to portray that triangular balloon as a big alien craft, yeah, that's possible as well. And, when you start linking up and you start learning and you start putting two and two together and the possibility of Blue Beam and the New World Order and how would they pull this off, it would be something like this. So, yeah, I'm holding that open for sure.
Yeah, I'm with you on that one. I'm like you. I go back and forth. Well, I go back and forth with military ET technology, back engineering technology, ET working with humans, something that Jim said earlier, humans not knowing that they're being deceived, war in the sky, war in the, I call it war in the skies, war in the heavens, if you will. Humankind didn't get the memo. And then there's Blue Beam. And Blue Beam is interesting because I feel that right here on Earth that we do have a very strong stepping up, if you will, of a global cabal. And I think they've got trillions of dollars to spend on this. So it's quite possible. And I hope nobody buys it if that's what it really turns out to be. So you're going to be around for a while, too. I have a quick question, Sean. Look up on the name of the person in the chat room wants to know what type of camera you're using.
Oh, I've got several. I've got a few cheap cameras that I've converted to infrared. I've got a Sony TRV-18, which is from 2002, which I've converted to infrared. But the latest thing I bought was a Canon SX50. And that's just a regular camera, but the beauty of that one is the price is under $400, and it's got a 50 times zoom lens on it, which is equivalent to a 1200 millimeter lens.
Give that name again.
The Canon SX50. Okay. It's a fairly new camera. And again, it's the zoom on it is where it's at. And 1200 millimeter zoom for under $400 in the camera package. And 12 megapixel, you can't beat it. So that's my new thing that I'm going with.
I'm sure everybody looks forward to seeing what you're going to shoot with that. You're going to be filming the moon with that one, aren't you?
Yeah, it goes in pretty well to the moon. And it's funny, the first photograph that I took of the moon with it showed color on the moon, just like Jose was saying.
Oh, doesn't that just rock your world?
Yeah, it blew my mind. It was like, well, let's zoom in and see what this camera's all about. And then I brought it on the computer, and there's purple and red splotches on the surface of the moon. I'm like, no way. And there it is, sitting right there. So this is going to be a lot of fun, and I'll probably try to get an infrared version of this or a full-spectrum version of the same camera and tinker with it. But, yeah.
Sounds good. Sounds good. Well, listen, everybody, we're getting close to the end of a show. It'll pop up here any moment. So I wanted to let everybody know who's listening that we've got Tuesday, James Gilliland is coming back from Isetti Ranch. And then next Friday, the 2nd, we have Norio Hayakawa speaking. I think Jim mentioned him earlier. We're going to talk about Dulce. And then, of course, we have a whistleblower coming on the 9th, Donald Marshall. Everyone keeps asking about Donald Marshall. Well, Donald Marshall is coming onto the show for 2 solid hours on August 9th. And boy, does he have some ET agenda going on. On the 13th, we have Stephen Bissett, who Paradigm Research Group and UFO Disclosure. He's going to talk about the citizens' hearing. And it goes on and on. Go to the schedule page and you can catch everything that we're up to. Jim, Sherry, and Sean, I want to thank you so much. It went by way too fast. We need like 6 hours to do a show like this.
I hear you.
Definitely. Absolutely. You know